Yeah, it is working.
Okay, well, then we are happy to have Yashwant Gupta here from GMIT. Yashwant is the chief scientist at GMIT. His personal research interests are mostly to do with pulsars, even though we started a collaboration which turned out to be an interesting overlap, which is research in ionization, so things that are quite different in nature and the different distances in the universe. But it turns out that we actually use pulsars as a essential part of our ionization search. And so we've had lots of discussions over the last few years since we've been started our project at GMIT. Yashwant did his PhD originally at UCSD in 1990, and he's been back at NCRA in India since then. And has really led to the, has gone leading the whole upgrade effort and development at GMIT, which we will hear about over the next hour. So, let's begin.
Thank you. And good afternoon. It's a pleasure to be here. Weli and myself have been, as he said, working for some time at the JMRT to do this new experiment, and we've learned quite a bit from CETA in terms of building computer clusters and running them at the observatory, as you will see. And so it's nice to be here and actually spend a few days. What I'm going to talk about is essentially to give you a broad view of the GMRT and tell you about how it works and highlight some of the recent science results that have come out in the early years of this telescope, and then also talk about our plans for the future as to how we plan to keep it as a competitive international facility over the years to come. So I'll start with some salient features about the telescope. And it's the GMRT is actually a low frequency radio telescope, and our frequency ranges from 50 megahertz to 1450 megahertz. That's 1000 megahertz is where most of the modern telescopes like take off, so we decided to concentrate on the low frequencies, and it's basically designed and primarily built by the National Center for Radio Astrophysics, which is where I work, with some collaboration with other institutes in India, like the Raman Research Institute. It's essentially an array telescope consisting of 30 antennas, each of which is very large, 45 meters in diameter, and it's one of the largest at these radio frequencies. Just a bit about where the GMRT is located. This is a map of India, and on the west here is Mumbai, which most people know about. And we are located near Mumbai, about 70 kilometers north of the city of Pune, and about due east of Mumbai. So that's the region over here where the telescope is located. Pune is where the headquarters of NCRA are. And if you go in there, this is what the configuration of the array looks like. So as I said, there are 30 antennas which are distributed in this kind of a fashion over the region, which is about roughly a 30 kilometer diameter region. There's a central compact array containing about 12, or depending on how you count, 14 antennas in the center, and the remaining are spread out along this roughly Y-shaped structure, which may remind you, say, of the VLA or something, typical Y-shaped array structure, with the longest baselines going up to 14 kilometers or so. And so essentially you can, in terms of the resolution, by combining the signals from such an array, you can basically synthesize a 28 kilometer size radio telescope, and which is one of the main modes of operation of the GMRT. But you can also use it as a phased array, which I will explain in a minute. So today nothing is complete without Google. And so if you just Google the GMRT, this is the picture that you see. So this shows very clearly a square, and that is really the central square. So 1 kilometer by 1 kilometer region, which has, that's much better, that shows the individual antennas, the central square antennas, and you can even start seeing some of the arm antennas which go out along the sides. There's an arm antenna there and so on. And if you get closer, you can actually start seeing the individual dishes, and these are the three centermost dishes in the most compact configuration, the shortest baselines. This is a view of the rest of the observatory. This is the main observatory building, located a little bit north of the antennas. Most of the antennas are in the central square, are down below here. And this is where the signals from all the antennas are brought back via optical fibers, and all the receivers for further processing of the signals are located here, including the control room, which is located here. And these are the guest house buildings. This is the most important part. This is the cricket pitch. you can see this is the little 22-yard strip where all the cricket battles are fought. This is a bird's eye view again showing the central square antennas. I'll just show you a few pictures before moving on. This is a view of that observatory building with the antennas in the background. This is just another view of a single antenna. This shot. So as you can notice, and which I will explain a little bit later, that it looks like the dishes are completely transparent. But I'll show you in a minute that that's not the case, obviously. This is a sequence showing the construction of a typical GMRT antenna, starting with the concrete tower on which the antenna structure is raised, and then you know the final working antenna. These antennas are quite large, and we have these special cranes called cherry pickers, which we use to service and get to the focus of the dish where the initial part of the electronics is located. Now, as I said earlier, that the main mode in which we operate is what is the traditional earth rotation aperture synthesis mode, whereby you synthesize a large aperture in terms of its resolution capabilities by combining the signals from individual antennas which are spread out over the aperture. This basically is done by using each pair as an interferometer and measuring one Fourier component of the image. And from 30 antennas, you get that many instantaneous Fourier components. And then you allow the rotation of the Earth to change the effective length of the baseline of any pair of antennas with respect to the source, thereby giving you more Fourier components. And that is, in technical jargon, is what we call the UV plane or the UV coverage. And so in effect, this is a map which shows the number of points in the UV plane that you can observe for a given source in a given direction of the sky over the full time, from the time the source rises to the time it sets in the sky. And so this is, so you measure the visibilities or the correlations between the antennas for all these data points, and then you do the offline inversion to get back the image. And so that's something that we all know, the basic aperture synthesis mode. But we also support what is called the phased array mode, which allows you to use the antennas in a tied array mode, just like a big bucket, to collect all the signals together, add them, without doing this interferometry. And that is useful for studying compact objects like pulsars, where you don't, you cannot resolve the structure of the emitting source with the size of the telescope that you have. So it's no point making an image. On the other hand, these are sources with very, very rapidly with time. So you would like to add the signals from all the antennas, keep it at the highest time and frequency resolution that you can afford, so that you can study in detail the structure of the source. And in this, the signals from all antennas are added together. And to do that, you have to phase up the signals properly, correct for the delays and the phases between the different antennas accurately before you can add that. And we support two modes of addition, which is what we call incoherent and coherent addition. So incoherent addition is where you would just take the signal from each antenna, convert it into an intensity that is detected, and then add the signals. Versus a coherent mode where you would actually add the voltages coming from all the antennas together, and then after addition, square law detect the signal and convert it into intensity. And these two modes are somewhat complementary. The incoherent mode, because you're throwing away the phase information and just adding intensities, gives you less sensitivity, that is less signal to noise than a coherent addition of the antennas. And so you may wonder why use the incoherent mode at all. And the reason is that the effective beam, that is the area of the sky that you can see, that is the same as a single dish beam in the incoherent mode. That means you can basically see the full area of the sky that a single dish can see, even though you are adding the signals from different antennas. Whereas in the phased array mode, the beam is actually much narrower as you phase up the signals and add them. And so if you want to do observation where you want to cover a large area of the sky, as for example in a survey looking for pulsars, and you want to optimize the time that you take to cover the sky, you would like to use the incoherent array mode as compared to the phased array mode, which is more useful for studying known objects sitting at the center of the field of view with the maximum sensitivity that you can get. So this is just an example of the phasing operation where the signals from different antennas have to be calibrated and brought to zero relative phase before you can add the voltages from the antennas. Now, in order to make these different modes of the GMRT work, there are different subsystems that go into it, and I'll briefly go over some of them, but I concentrate more on the receiver, the actual analog and digital receiver chains, because that is what really finally decides the kind of processing that you can do, the kind of observations that are feasible. But behind it are all the other things, which mechanical, servo, and the online, the real-time control and monitoring software, and so on. So this is what I was saying earlier, that there is a reflecting surface, but it is a mesh, and it's and you can see the sunlight shining off the mesh, and you can make it out. And this is adequate for the frequencies at which we work. And so it works quite well for the low frequencies, but as you go to higher frequencies, this would become a very leaky reflector and you would lose much of the signal. The mechanical system is basically, there are two novel things. One is the fact that one has used this light mesh, which reduces the weight and therefore the cost of the antennas, as well as a new technique that was invented in order to provide the mechanical support to the structure. So there are basically these parabolic frames which give the basic shape to the antenna, and then the actual reflecting surface is attached to basically a rope truss system, steel ropes which are strung between the parabolic frames and tensioned to maintain the required accuracy of the surface. And then the reflecting mesh is just anchored to the structure. And basically, this makes the antennas very light, and therefore you can have a 45 meter size antenna, which weighs only about 80 tons or so, and is fully steerable. This is just a quick overview of the servo system. So it's basically a two-axis altazimuth mount system with the azimuth system over here, which has the basically the thing on which it rotates, and then the elevation system has a bull gear drive for moving it, and there is also a servo system related to the feed, where you have the different frequency feeds mounted at the focus, which I'll show you in a minute. So these are the main parameters of a single dish, where the interesting thing is, as I said, the weight, which is quite light, and the total physical aperture, which is quite large. And so the effective aperture is about 1,000 square meters, given the typical aperture efficiency of 65% that one can achieve in a radio telescope. And it has a pointing accuracy from the servo system of 1 arc minute, typical. So, as I said earlier, that we operate at the low frequency band. So these are the bands of operation from 50 megahertz up to L band, that is 1450 megahertz. And there are 6 distinct bands, and each of which is achieved by a feed which works over that frequency range. So, and these feeds, which are basically different kinds of receiver systems, either dipoles or horn feeds or coaxial waveguide feeds, these are mounted at the focus of the dish on a rotating turret, which can be rotated with the commands sent remotely from the control room to bring the desired frequency at the focus. These are all in operation. The 50 megahertz system is still under prototype development stage, which we hope to be able to mass produce shortly. So this is a block diagram of the analog receiver chain. So basically, you have 30 antennas, each with these dual polarized feeds, which are typically linear polarizations when they come from the feed element, but are converted into circular polarizations in most of the wave bands. And then the circularly polarized signal goes through a fairly traditional receiver chain. It's basically a heterodyne receiver chain, except that it has a few different stages of heterodyne conversion to convert to different IF frequencies, partly because of constraints of having to send the two IF frequencies on a single fiber back. So there is this part of the electronics resides at the base of the antenna, where you convert the signals to two different IF frequencies, one for each polarization, and then those modulate a laser diode, which is connected to the optical fiber, which brings the signals to the central building, and then you demodulate back to electrical, and then you further convert it down to baseband signals. And the baseband signals, you can get a maximum bandwidth of 32 megahertz at any one of the frequency of operation. And that's the current constraint of the system, is to give a maximum of 32 megahertz. The outputs from all the 30 antennas, the final baseband converted analog signals, then go to the digital backend system, which produces the final outputs of interest. And so this digital system basically has two main components, an FX correlator, which takes care of the interferometry requirement. That is, it produces the visibility or the correlation between every pair of antennas, and then a pulsar receiver, which works in the array mode, where you can add the signals from all the antennas and give the final output. And the useful thing is that both of these can operate simultaneously. So you can be observing a given source in the sky and be using it to both process the data interferometrically as well as in a phased array mode. So the net data rate coming into this is about 2 gigasamples per second, which is what you would get after the digitization. So you go through a digitization stage, correction of the variable amount of delay on the propagation of the signal from the antenna to the central building, as well as from the source to the antenna. And then the output goes to a spectral engine. So there's a FFT engine which gives you spectra, 256 channel spectra which come out, and it also allows you to do fine correction of the delay and phase derotation of the signals. And the outputs from here are then split into two. One section goes to what we call the multiply and accumulate, which is the unit which will produce pairwise products for the signals from all the antennas and give the final visibility output. The other unit, which allows you to selectively add any subset of antennas together to give the incoherent array output and the phased array output, which are further processed by DSP-based receivers. And finally, the data is output to standard PC-based data acquisition systems, and it is recorded to disk for further processing. This is an overview of the telemetry, that is a monitor and control system, which basically runs off the main Unix, now a Linux-based computer, in the control room, and it talks to all the antennas through through the fiber link with the outgoing channel, which carries the commands to all the antennas, as well as brings back the telemetry information from all the antennas, and controls all the electronics at each of the antenna, as well as monitors the parameters. So antenna positioning and movement, the feed positioning control, configuration of the entire analog receiver chain, and monitoring of all the safety parameters at each antenna. In addition, it also provides for a voice link to each antenna, whereby if you are at the antenna base, you can pick up a phone and talk to the control room. This is a quick view of the control software, which runs the entire telescope, and it basically talks via the telemetry system to all the antennas and decodes the information that comes back and allows the user to have a look at things, as well as an automated control for tracking of the antennas. And it supports modes whereby you can run the telescope in different subarrays. That means you can split it into smaller groups of antennas, which could be observing a different source in the sky or observing at a different frequency, and you can still run the whole thing that way and let the data flow through and make sense of it at the final output of the backend. So this is a table which is of most interest to all users, which is a summary of the performance figures. So these are the five bands at which things are working actively right now, and this gives the primary beam, that is the size of the beam produced by the single antenna in the sky, which goes from about a bit over 3 degrees down to about half a degree at the highest frequency. And this is the synthesized beam. So when you make the image, the final resolution that you can get in the image, which goes down from about 20 arc seconds to a couple of arc seconds at the highest frequency. And this is the effective area that the whole array produces, that is 1,000 square meters effective area per antenna, which becomes a bit less at the higher frequencies, because at those frequencies the mesh starts to become a bit leaky. There's a system noise temperatures, the usable region of the frequency spectrum that you can use, which is partly constrained by radio frequency interference and partly by the design of the feeds. This is the number of most interest. It's basically the RMS sensitivity, that is the RMS level of noise in millijanskis that you would achieve in a typical 2 to 3 hour long observation with the full array using the full bandwidth at the different frequencies. And similarly, this is the typical dynamic range in the images that one would achieve while making the images at the different frequencies. And these numbers are all the time improving and becoming better and better as people learn how to get the best out of the data from the telescope.
What's the magnitude change from 610 to 327?
In what?
In our mass sensitivity. I mean, this is almost the same at 610 and 327. And your best RMS sensitivity.
Yeah. So this is where the problems of either RFI or ionospheric fluctuations and the other problems start creeping in as you go to the lower frequencies. And so what has happened is that people have got around to analyzing these frequencies quite relatively easily and get higher or better noise figures. But here, they're still harder to do the same. Which you know, we know by the way at 150 megahertz that how much work is required to remove all the unwanted stuff from the signals and get to the best sensitivity. But like I said, all these numbers are you know, constantly improving. I know now people who have got maps at these frequencies which go down to a few hundred microjanskis, a couple of hundred microjanskis kind of maps at 325 megahertz. So, and even here. There are now maps which have achieved 20 microjanskis at 610 megahertz, you know, which is about a factor of 5 better than what's there on the table.
So what's your dynamic range?
Sorry?
What's up to the dynamic range?
What limits that? Yeah. It's again mostly calibration related issues. So how well you can calibrate low frequency effects. And so that's the thing that people, again, have been working on and steadily improving. So you can, people have been getting higher dynamic ranges than this in the maps. But it's basically limited by how well you understand the calibration issues.
So
how well you can take care of it. Sorry?
Like intensity calibration or beam calibration?
It's mostly the phase calibration. Yeah. So you you know, how often you calibrate, how stable is the calibration between your calibration runs on the phase calibrator and so on. This is a similar table for the array mode of operation where basically you, the question you want to ask is that if I'm looking at a known pulsar, then what signal to noise I'll achieve in a given integration time over the bandwidth, or if I'm searching and I take data for a certain duration, what is the weakest pulsar that I could detect in that. And so you can, in 10 minutes of observing with the full incoherent array, you can go down to 1 millijansky strength of pulsars. And if you're looking at single pulses, that is, you want to see each and every pulse from the pulsar, then you can see it at the level of, say, some 5 sigma detection for a 35 millijansky pulsar using the full array in phased array mode. So a few words about how GMRT operates. It's basically open for international use since January 2002, and it runs now in 6 monthly cycles, where 5 months are used for scheduled observations and 1 month is reserved for maintenance, upgrade, improvement activities. And there are proposal deadlines for each cycle, which are on July 15th and January 15th, and for operations which typically start on 1st of November and 1st of May. And the proposals are screened by the GMRT time allocation committee and are allotted observing time, after which we make the schedule for how the observations should be done. And in addition to the regular proposals, requests for special observations like target of opportunity observations can be made, and these are then decided by the center director at NCRA for allotment of time. These are some usage statistics so since from the beginning we are now in the 14th cycle, there have been a total of 840 proposals, of which about a 10% rejection rate, and the total amount of telescope time allotted is basically about a factor of half of what the total amount of time asked for. So it's a oversubscription rate of about close to 2. And there are users from all over the world, and it's interesting that when we started, there were more users from within the country using the telescope. And slowly, I think as its popularity has grown, we have now more users from outside applying for time. And as you can see, the breakup people from all over who come and use the telescope. So we don't, we are right now not able to provide for remote observing, so we encourage people to come to the observatory at the time when their observations are scheduled. So there are different things that can be done with the GMRT, and I just show you a few sample results and then move on to some of the future plans. Supernova remnants, there are quite a few new supernova remnants that have been discovered with the GMRT, and as an example of one of the very first results that was obtained with the GMRT before it was, while it was still in testing phase, new supernova remnants, mostly at the lower frequencies, 325 and 610 megahertz. Then from supernova remnants.
Total intensity, or we have also polarized images there?
Sorry.
The polarized images of these supernova remnants?
Sorry, I didn't get your question.
Polarized images.
Polarized images. The polarization mode is just about getting going now. So I don't think anybody has yet made polarized images of these with the GMRT. People are just about, I'll show you some results from polarization observations later on, but they're still in the beginning phases. So nobody really has done that with the supernova remnants so far. So from supernova remnants, next hop is pulsars, which is also my area of work. And this is one of the interesting results that we had from GMRT, the first discovery of a pulsar with the GMRT. It turned out to be a fairly interesting pulsar. So we did a search looking in globular clusters to find pulsars. And this is a globular cluster NGC 1851, where we found a pulsar almost right at the, located almost at the center of the cluster. It turns out to be a fairly interesting pulsar. It's a millisecond pulsar, which is what the most of the pulsars in globular clusters are. But what was surprising was that it was an unusual millisecond pulsar. It has a period of 5 milliseconds or so, but what we found is that it is in a very interesting binary orbit, where if you look at the variation of the period of the pulsar as a function of time, this is here day number, the period varies dramatically, and not in this nice, you know, sinusoidal or slow manner, but in a very abrupt change of period in one part of the cycle, and then a slow recovery back. And this basically is the signature of a very eccentric orbit, where the neutron star is going around periastron in this short interval of 5 hours out of a total binary period of about 18 days or so. And we were able to infer that this is an orbit which has an eccentricity of 0.9, which is, you know, really something which is just zipping like this. It probably is the highest eccentric binary pulsar orbit to date.
What's the paracenter?
Sorry?
What's the periaps of the orbit?
It's about 45 light seconds, I mean the size.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, like, so units of like, what the Schwarzschild radius of the pulsar, what would that be?
It's still much larger than that, yeah. So it really
so
doesn't.
Like a very non-relativistic system.
It is relativistic, but not very highly relativistic. So we've been doing timing observations to see if we can measure some of the relativistic parameters for this pulsar. But the companion is most likely a white dwarf star. I mean, if it had been another neutron star, and then with this eccentricity, then at the point of periastron, that would have been really, really exciting. But it didn't turn out to be that. It's from whatever we have gathered from the timing, it looks like it's a white dwarf companion. But it's interesting to ask what produces such highly eccentric binary systems and globular clusters, and that's basically the three-body interactions and so on that come into play. There's another interesting pulsar that we discovered with the GMRT. This one is opposite of a globular cluster pulsar, which is a very old pulsar. This is a pulsar in a supernova remnant, very young pulsar. So this is supernova remnant G21.5.0.9 in X-rays, and we were doing a search looking at some of these supernova remnants where pulsars have not been found, and this was the first one that we saw. It's a 60 millisecond period pulsar, and follow-up observations show that it has a very high E dot, the loss of energy. It's highest after the Crab pulsar in the galaxy. So you talked about polarization. So this is an example of studying pulsars in polarization, which requires, as we all know, a proper calibration of the instrumental effects, which is one of the things that's been, you know, holding up detailed polarization studies. But now people have gotten around to that. So we were able to characterize the output of the phased array, treat it like a single dish, and carry out a polarization calibration like you would carry out for a single dish, and show that it actually works. And you can measure the leakage terms in the polarization and be able to correct for it and recover the proper polarized intensity of the pulsar signal. So this is an example at 325 megahertz for this well-known pulsar 1929+10, which is used as a standard polarization calibrator, where this is the total intensity, this is a linear polarization, and this is the circular polarization after correction for the instrumental effects. So this is now possible to do that. And this is an example of something which not many observatories can do, which is to produce polarization profiles at low frequencies like 150 megahertz. And once again, one can recover the polarization reasonably well. And this is now is what is being extended to the interferometry mode to see if that can be done routinely. Moving on to other objects, this is a there was a fairly detailed study done by Subhashish Roy, who did his PhD on studying the galactic center. And there are interesting results. First detection of Sagittarius A star at relatively low frequency of 610 megahertz, and the detailed structure at 150 megahertz of the galactic center region with fairly decent RMS, 25 millijanskis, for a direction like the galactic center, which has a very high background noise. This is again a nice image which doesn't come out very well here, but it shows, that's much better now. You can see lots of structure here, supernova remnants, filaments, and all kinds of details. This is done at, I think, 330 megahertz with a 1 millijansky noise level. And this is a nearby region, slightly away from here, where you can see details at a higher level of 0.5 millijanskys or so.
Well, would you be sensitive to see any time variation of the synchrotron emission there in the supernova remnants?
Time variation?
Yes. I mean, there was a big claim, or there was a big discovery from Chandra, basically time variation of Chandra X-ray filaments there. And could you see such a thing there in the radio as well?
Okay, I don't think people have really looked for time variation of this, but people have looked for transient sources near the galactic center. And if you remember, there was this report of a source that goes off every 72 minutes. Near the galactic center, and that has been detected with the JMRT, and people have tried to study its properties. But I don't think anybody has done the study of actually, you know, time variability of the That would be interesting if it actually can be seen on time scales of weeks to months.
Well, their time scale they claim is a year basically. They see it lighting up and increase on a yearly time scale, like, you know, back to China.
That would be interesting. I mean, if one could work out the equivalent variation expected in the radio, one could actually see whether that's doable. This is an example of molecular lines, again from Sagittarius B2 in this case. And this is a study done where CH3CHO was detected and likely to be mazed at 1065 megahertz, which is again a frequency which is difficult to observe at many other observatories. And these basically are some of the only maps which can be made at this frequency for these kind of structures to see these details. Then just moving out to extragalactic, there's a neat example showing what the frequency resolution and sensitivity of the JMRT can do. So this is Aisha Begum did her PhD studying dwarf galaxies, and this is an example of a map of a dwarf galaxy showing a VLA result, and then the same object mapped to the GMRT. And if you looked at it, you would say that there is no velocity structure for this galaxy, but with enough detail and sensitivity, you can actually see systematic velocity structure and therefore infer a rotation for these kind of galaxies. And they did this work in detail, where here's an example where another dwarf galaxy was studied in detail, and you could actually see H1 emission out to very large distances, you know, well beyond the optical counterpart, so going out to 8.3 times the Hohenberg radius, and you can actually, they were able to map out systematic rotation curve for this, and show that this is one of the most extended H1 disks known. And if you study it in detail, you can measure the rotation curve out to 38 times optical disk scale length, and infer that this is one of the darkest known irregular galaxies with a master light ratio of as high as 100. So there's, you know, there's lots of this matter which which shows up only in the H1 maps. This is a different example, looking at large radio galaxies, giant quasars. So this is a GMRT map at 330 megahertz. Once again, the faint bridge, which is supposed to be there, is not easily visible. But yeah, there you can see a little bit of that now. And this was, so this is such a huge source that if you did not have this evidence, you would think that these were independent sources. But you can actually trace out with the sensitivity of the GMRT faint bridge of emission, showing that this is a triple source and therefore one of the largest giant radio galaxies, measuring maybe about 1 megaparsec in overall size. There's another interesting kind of radio galaxies, which have got the name now of X-shaped radio galaxies, which show this very peculiar morphology, which you don't see in a typical radio galaxy, where you have these emission from two hotspots, but then you also have this structure which shows emissions in other directions. And there's been a detailed study done by Dharamveer Lal, who's a postdoc, and the different aspects being investigated as to is this a shifting jet with different epochs of activities, or are these mergers, or what?
Do you see the host galaxies ever, or
sorry?
Do you ever see the host galaxies for those systems, optically?
I'm not sure whether they have. I think they have the host galaxy in some cases, but probably not in all.
You don't seem like disturbed. Or
yeah, so that's. I mean, so there was some evidence that there may be actually, you know, disturbed systems due to mergers, but then there's some others where you don't have any supporting evidence, and then. They've tried to investigate whether it can be explained with this kind of thing where the jet is actually moving around and there are different epochs of activity of the jet. So this is again another example from molecular studies where the same authors, but this time detecting OH in extragalactic at intermediate redshifts, and again showing that there is a good correlation between NOH and NHCO. That therefore indicating that OH may be a good tracer of molecular hydrogen at cosmological distances, which would be a useful way then to probe things. This is a different kind of study, gamma ray bursts. So there have been many gamma ray bursts that have been followed up with the GMRT to look for the radio afterglow. And this is one example where this particular GRB was followed up, and one was able to detect the afterglow for several hundreds of days. And it's probably one of the longest ever radio follow-up at the lowest radio frequencies for a GRB. And they could show that the jet becomes sub-relativistic for 60 days after the burst. And this was part of the PhD work of Resmi from the Raman Research Institute in Bangalore. This another kind of transient sources, supernovae. So there have been a lot of observations done of supernovae as they go off. And Poonam Chandra did her PhD thesis working on some of these. And this is an example, a nice one, where data from two different observatories has been combined to bring out a new result. So, I mean, if you had just either the VLA data or only the GMRT data, you would not easily infer a break. And this break allows you then to make a direct, estimate of the magnetic field for this object. This is now a different kind of observations where people have been doing deep observations of some of these selected fields. And this is an example at 150 megahertz done by my colleague at NCRE, Ishwar Chandra, where they have been able to image a very large field of view, 3 degrees, with a fairly good resolution and fairly good RMS noise. And the comparison of the source counts with other surveys like NBSS and WENS shows that you can basically see all the sources seen there plus a few more, and you can get the spectra of sources and do further follow-up studies. And this, so there's lots of interesting sources that can be seen in this kind of field of view. And this is an example of comparison with the other surveys, and then the establishing the spectra and looking for steep spectrum sources. This is another example at 610 megahertz, deep observations of the Spitzer field, which carried out by Timothy Garn, Dave Green in Cambridge. And these are seven pointings, so a total of 4 square degrees of the sky with a resolution of about 5 arcseconds and very good RMS noise getting down to tens of microjanskis, and detected a large number of sources. And they compared it with the VLA image of the same field at 1.4 gigahertz, very similar resolutions, similar noise levels, and a similar number of sources, slightly higher number of sources detected at 610 megahertz of the GMRT. So there's a maps, one from the VLA, the other from the GMRT, of the same field of view at 1.4 gigahertz and 610 megahertz, and they look fairly comparable. So GMRT has been sort of operational for about, about six years now, and it's already many different results coming. And at the current level at which it operates, probably continue to produce new results in the next few years. But we are already looking ahead of that to, say, the next 10 years and asking that what is it that we need to do in order to improve it and to keep it internationally, competitive, given the fact that lots of other new telescopes like LOFAR and others are going to come up at low frequencies. And what we have decided to do is to improve the performance of the GMRT in terms of the frequency coverage. So we'd like to try and provide seamless frequency coverage from 30 megahertz to 15 megahertz instead of the limited bands with the 32 megahertz bandwidth that we have at present. And we would like at the same time to improve the G over T sys, that is the gain over the system noise temperature, which you can't change the gain because that's pretty much a property of the antenna, but you can certainly try and reduce the system noise temperature by better electronics, and that's now being tried out. And most importantly, we'd like to increase the instantaneous bandwidth up to 400 megahertz maximum as compared to the 32 megahertz that we provide right now. And that again would require a radically new design of the receiver chain and the backend system. All of these things are now in progress. I'll show you a few examples of some of these. And then at the same time, we'll improve the server system, replace it with a modern server system, and a more modern and versatile control and monitor system, and better offline computing facilities and related infrastructure. But the thrust of it is these three things, which would drastically improve the performance of the telescope. And all of this is now being funded. We have these 5-year funding cycles, and the current one, which runs from 2007 to 2012, now has approval for the funding to go ahead and do this upgrade. And so work has already started, and here are some examples. This is the, as part of that, we are building this 50 megahertz feed in collaboration with the Raman Research Institute, which will increase our coverage from 30 to 80 megahertz. The prototype on four antennas is now up and tests are going on. Then we're looking at other broadband feeds. So this is a feed designed with CSIRO to go from 550 to 850 megahertz, which is also up on the antennas being tested. Another feed from 250 to 750 megahertz in collaboration with Chalmers University being tried out. We're improving our own existing feeds. The 150 megahertz fat folded dipoles are being improved to give a coverage from 130 to 280 megahertz. And so all of these are in the prototype testing stage. And based on that, decisions for mass production will be taken. Front-end systems, broadband high dynamic range, low noise temperature amplifiers at room temperature without cooling are being tried out. And already we've got a few prototypes which once again are being tested along with the feeds. This is an example of LNA to match with the 550 to 850 megahertz feed, which goes down to a temperature of about 35 degree Kelvin without cryogenics. In order to bring back the broadband signals of 400 megahertz bandwidth, we have to completely revamp the way we transport signals on the optical fiber. So this again prototype has been built and installed on two antennas, which uses dense wavelength division multiplexing techniques to bring back broader bandwidth signals along with the telemetry and control signals. And what is most important for us is to be able to do this while keeping the existing systems running so that we can continue to use the GMRT in its present mode even as these upgrade items are tried out. So this is just a example showing the electronics that has been designed and built for the new optical fiber system. The back-end systems are being looked at as two main possibilities. One is to use FPGA-based systems to do the job for processing the 400 megahertz bandwidth from each antenna, or to try out software-based processors like software backends, which I'll show you an example in a minute. And this is an example of some of the FPGA boards that we are talking about with colleagues from Berkeley to see if we can use those to build next generation digital backend. This is an example of the software-based approach, which is the one we started with Bailey Penn and Jeff Peterson. So we now have built a software-based backend where the analog data from the antennas is digitized by ADC, which actually sits on a regular computer on the PCI bus, and the data from there is transferred to these processors, and then the processors exchange the data between them and do all the computations required to realize both the interferometer and the phased array receiver that I showed you earlier. So what we have now got going, which is under testing phase right now, is a 32 antenna system that can handle 32 megahertz bandwidth dual polarization, which is, as I said earlier, is some 2 gigasamples per second flowing into the system. And the array of compute nodes then implements an effects correlator and a beamformer. And it just uses completely off-the-shelf components and implements a fully real-time backend. It's probably the first time that a fully real-time backend for a moderately large array of 32 antennas is being realized for fairly, again, for moderately large bandwidths like 32 megahertz. This is a detailed layout of the system. I'm not going into the details of this, but there are basically one set of acquisition nodes which acquire the data, and then a set of nodes which do most of the computing, and a set of nodes which can do the recording of the data. So it supports two kinds of modes. One is you can take the raw data, dump it to disk, and then analyze it offline and do the calculations. The other is, like I said, the real-time mode where you take the data in, do all the computations that you need in real-time, and then put out the final visibilities or the reduced data, just like the hardware backend puts out for storage to disk. We have plans for expanding this further, where we can hope to take the data from the observatory all the way to our campus in Pune via a dedicated optical fiber link that we have, which we have enhanced now to a 4 gigabit per second connectivity. And then we can bring to bear the power of much larger compute clusters which are available on the university campus for doing some of the offline analysis. And the kind of things that one is interested in this more detailed offline analysis is to do things like produce multiple phased array beams to cover the entire primary beam for getting much higher sensitivity over the entire field of view. This involves collaborations with the group that does supercomputing on the university campus to be able to see if we can connect to their large cluster for the processing. These are just some examples of first light results using the software backend. This is a pulsar data stream, single pulses from one of the brightest pulsars observed using the incoherent array output of the software backend. This is first one of the earlier images of point source calibrated made using the software backend data. In parallel, there's this major exercise that has been going on using this newly developed software backend to see if we can detect the signal from the epoch of reionization, which is led by people from here, Jeff Peterson, and some of us at GMRT. And in the process, lots of new things have been done and tried out. And so Weili and Suxing have developed special algorithms for rejecting RFI, which has led to almost a 100-fold improvement in the RMS noise in the data before and after rejection of the RFI. So the 150 megahertz band is one of the ones which is more prone to radio frequency interference from local man-made transmitters, and a lot of effort in improving the quality of the data goes in trying to get rid of the interference. And then we've come up with this technique to use the pulsars as an in-field phase calibrator, which requires you to implement a gated interferometer. That means your interferometer collects data separately for the on and off phases of the pulsar and subtracts them to give you a phase calibration, and then also use the polarized signal of the pulsar for doing the polarization calibration. And so there's a full analysis pipeline that has been now developed, which does all these things with the GMRT software backend data. And some of the results, so there's been observations of this selected field containing a known pulsar to understand sensitivity levels and effects of polarized galactic foreground signals. And a paper that's just been sent now shows that there's no significant amount of polarized emission that's been detected. And this is good news for the EOR experiment, as this is about an order of magnitude lower than what one would have expected or one would have thought may be present based on extrapolations from results at higher frequencies. And there's even otherwise, the amount of polarization from extragalactic sources is also quite small, less than about 1% or so. And these are pilot observations, and though they have helped a lot to understand the issues involved and to drastically improve the processing and come up with better results, they're still a bit short in terms of the sensitivity that is required to detect the EOR signal. And so there's still more work to be done, and I guess we will be observing again in the next few months, taking deeper observations to see how far we can push with that. Okay, then just a few other things related to the upgrade of the control telemetry system, which is going to be modernized with the Ethernet-based control all the way from the central computer to the remote antennas, and similarly revamping of a servo system, replacing motors with modern brushless motors, and improved control computers, and so on. Right, that's what I have. Thank you.
show the dwarf galaxies again?
Yeah. This one?
Yeah, okay. Yeah, or even this. Yeah. So what was the reason why GMRT can go to the more sensitive?
One was just the frequency resolution that one could achieve. And so this was done with a coarser frequency resolution, and therefore coarser velocity resolution. This is done with a better velocity resolution, and then the effective raw sensitivity is better here as compared to the VLA.
Because like the receivers
are because of the larger number of antennas and the larger size of the antennas. I mean, actually, our receivers are not as good as the VLA in terms of their system noise temperature. But it's just the total collecting area that we have is significantly more than the VLA.
And on the following slide, I guess maybe the one after. I mean, the rotation curve, right? I mean, okay. So the size of the actual galaxy is like one in these units. Is that what you said?
Yes.
Okay. And so the rotation curve is actually still rising quite strongly. So it's possible to do this for other dwarf galaxies?
I think if you look at Aisha's thesis, they've done a bunch of galaxies, but this was the most dramatic one, and that's why
it gets. Typical. I mean, this is not a typical system that you're saying.
Well, but in most of them, they find that there is much more matter than what you can see in the optical image of the dwarf galaxy.
Yeah, but as the amplitude of the rotation curve, larger. Is a larger, I guess, the gas disk than is measured by the stellar disk. Because that's the main sort of question in this field.
Yeah. So I'm not sure what the exact answer to that one is from their work. I guess you should maybe look up some of their papers or see that. But what I remember is that in many of them they found this kind of a property. And they were able to. Yeah.
Just have an idea of your mapping speed. So you have the next slide is the first look field, the spacer field.
Yeah.
Do you have some idea how long it took? It was the integration to cover that four square units that.
I think these were. I think these were 8 hour, eight hour runs on each field. I mean, maybe 8 or 10 or something, but in that ballpark. Because you need that to achieve the 30 micro Janskis is a full rotation synthesis noise level.
Not thank Ashwin again.